Good evening, everyone. We're going to get things started here. My name is James Fisher. I'm the general manager of the Hartford Club, and I just want to welcome you to the Hartford Club and tell you how happy we are to be able to work with the Connecticut Young Writers Trust. I think what you're doing is great, and we're proud to be a part of it. And you're in a place that has produced some very special writers, including Mark Twain. So I thought I would leave you with a little quote from Mark Twain. Especially for you young writers. He said, "When I was 14, my father was so ignorant I could hardly stand to have him around. When I got to be 21, I was astonished at how much he had learned in 7 years." Enjoy your night, folks.
And that is just part of the wonderful history of this very distinctive club. So I think that you should probably, we had the dinner 1 year at the Mark Twain House, so we wanted to kind of continue in that writer's feeling. So I hope you're glad about that. And this is a club that has a whole new life and a whole new group of people that are joining, all kinds of new programs, very exciting place to be. So I'm glad to have you with us. I'm Diane Smith. For those of you that haven't met me before, I am on the board of directors of the Young Writers Awards. I'm one of the judges. I'm also working at the Connecticut Network, which is your CTN station, where you can watch all governmental affairs, as well as tonight's program. I do some programming on CPTV, and I'm also a writer. I have my fifth book coming out this week. I'll be starting the book tour in just a few days, so I feel your pain. This is our 13th annual Connecticut Young Writers Celebration, where, as you know, we honor some of the state's best young writers. In 13 years, we have fielded entries from more than 6,000 writers, including tonight's 16 state finalists who are already winners in their counties, and we have awarded close to $200,000 in prize money. So, first of all, how about a round of applause for the musicians who entertain us during the reception? They are the Cosmic Jibaros, and they're giving way now to our Connecticut Young Writers House Band, the Jen Allen Big Band, who will be playing during dinner. As they set up, we do have a few people we'd like to thank. An event like this one would be impossible without the generous gifts of time, talent, and money by dozens of people across the state. There's no way to thank everybody, but I'd like to at least make a stab at a few people. Among the teachers and educators who have helped us, John Becker of the Williams School, Ted Richmond of Montville High School. I'll let you hold your applause till we get to the end of the teachers. Montville High School, Victoria Nordland, Rockville High School, Barbara Greenbaum, Arts at the Capitol Theater, Deborah Casey, Danbury High School, Lisa Ferrari, Litchfield High School, Pamela Aubin, the Montville School Superintendent. Thank you so much. Now some of our sponsors, and you may notice that they are heavy into attorneys, and that's because Andy has needed a lot of legal help over the years. Actually, Andy Thibault, who is our founder, has been an investigative reporter and an investigator himself, and in fact has gotten to know a lot of attorneys, sometimes on the right side of the law, sometimes when he's been on the wrong side of the law, but we don't talk about that in public, so forget you heard that. But I'd like to thank some of our sponsors tonight, and you'll see them in our program. Attorney Jack Horak, Attorney John Kennelly, Attorney Kevin Creed, Jackie Manning of Integrated Security, Attorney Jeff Dressler, and Sammy Vega of Mega Education. I'd also like to thank Attorney Bill Crow, who is the father of the 2005 State Prose Champion, Charlotte Crow, who is now at Brown University and interning with the New Yorker's poetry editor. Nice gig. I'd also like to thank CCSU Professor David Capella, who was a workshop presenter for our January event, the Triple KO event. So thank you to all of our sponsors very much. We have a number of our board members here today. If you're a board member of the Connecticut Young Writers Trust, would you stand, please, so we can all recognize you? Thank you very much. Virginia. Thank you. Very good to see you. Some of our board members include Dr. John Tyndall Gibson, the Naugatuck School Superintendent, Carol Thibault, who is not related to Andy, as she likes everybody to know, Virginia Fisher, who is my producer on a documentary that we just produced on Living Modern in Connecticut, just won an Emmy Award. Thank you, Virginia. was wonderful. Cindy Cormier is on our panel. Cindy runs, and if you haven't been, you must make the year that you go, the Hillstead Poetry Festival, poetry in the Sunken Garden at Hillstead. It's a remarkable experience, and it makes you think differently about our state when you realize that hundreds of people show up on a summer night to sit outside and listen to some of the most wonderful poetry that you could ever hear, and they're just in rapt attention at the most beautiful place. And Cindy, I know you want to thank everybody and welcome them all to come this year. When does the Poetry Festival start? Oh, wonderful. Galway Canal has been there before and has been a huge hit. Don't miss it. It is really a fabulous night. People come with picnics and wine, and it's wonderful, right? It's just, Kate Russian knows, it's just fabulous. Yeah, there's nothing else like it. It's wonderful. Some of the other judges, novelist Chandra Prasad, Pam Lewis, Susan Gilmore, Therese Carmel, who's right here, has been one of our most loyal judges over the years, Paul Doyle, Suzanne Davis. So thank you to all of those judges and the others who helped us this year. Thank you very much. We have a few other board members and sponsors that we'd like to thank. You know, with Andy, nothing's ever really in any particular order, so we just get to it as we get to it. But I'd like to thank Vince Valvo. Thank you, Vince. He's been a judge and a board member, and he's a publisher. Linda Valvo, John Salato, Sue Salato, Denning Powell, Dr. Joe Bentivenga. Oh, Andy also brings all of his doctors in eventually. Everyone who's a doctor eventually gets into the family. The assistant AG, Lynn Wittenbrink, the mother of the keynote speaker, Lauren Heffron, and Bill Sievis, who's right here, who is the Chancellor Emeritus of the Connecticut State University System, who over the years has been a tremendous champion to us. And really, this program would never have gotten off the ground as a statewide program without Bill's help. He's been instrumental in many other initiatives in this state, including one that I'm really particularly interested in right now, and that is ctmirror.org, which is a nonprofit news organization online that has taken up the gap where many news organizations have left off, when the Hartford Current and many other organizations shrank their staffs by quite a bit. Bill and several others felt that there wasn't going to be adequate coverage of the government and of some other important issues like education in our state, and they started CT Mirror, which is just a top-level site that people like me read every single day, several times a day. So Bill, thank you for that as well. He's been a great public servant. And before they serve dinner and while the band is setting up, I just would like to read this letter to you. This is a letter from Governor M. Jody Rell. It says, "Dear friends, on behalf of the state of Connecticut, it is my pleasure to extend greetings to all those who have gathered at the 13th Annual Connecticut Young Writers Competition Awards being held at the Hartford Club in Hartford. I commend all of the participants involved in the Connecticut Young Writers Competition as you celebrate and share your personal works of poetry and prose. I would like to take this opportunity to recognize and welcome tonight's guest speakers, Lauren Heffron and Bob Leuci. I would also like to personally thank all of the staff and volunteers of both Impact and the Connecticut State University System who have contributed their time and energy to ensure that this event is a great success. Please know that all of you have my best wishes for a successful awards ceremony and great success in all your future endeavors. Sincerely, M. Jody Rell, Governor of the State of Connecticut." So, we're going to have some dinner, listen to some music, and then we'll pick up our program after that. Thank you so much. Just a little taste of what you're going to hear from the Jen Allen Big Band. That was just their sound check, if you can believe it. But first, we thought we'd get into our program a little bit, if I could get your attention just for a minute here. Can everybody hear me? Can you hear me all the way in the back? And you can? Okay, great. How about Vince Valvo? Can you hear me over there, Vince? Okay, great. Perfect. So we got the whole room. All right, good. It is my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Lauren Heffron. Lauren was the 2003 state prose champion. She is a recent graduate of Yale University. As we've learned over the years, right, Vince, one of the benefits of winning the award is you practically guaranteed admission to an Ivy League school. At least that's what we've observed. I wish I'd known about this when I was that age. Her work has been published in the Connecticut Review, the literary journal of the Connecticut State University System. While she was at Yale, Lauren worked as a copy editor for a non-governmental organization in Madrid. She also served as a tutor at the Yale College Writing Center and wrote newspaper editorials and website copy. Among her favorite creative assignments, one-page narratives for Yale's legendary Daily Themes course. She intends to study English at some point at the graduate level, but her next assignment is going to be in the Washington, D.C. school system. Lauren is joining Teach for America and will be assigned to an inner city school. Lauren Heffern.
Hi, everyone. Can you all hear me? I'm bad with microphones. Okay. I just want to say thank you, first of all, to everyone who makes this possible. I know for me as a 14-year-old, it sure meant a lot, and it continues to mean a lot to the kids that are sitting here tonight. So to everyone who's here who has anything to do with that, thank you from me, and thank you from all of the kids who look kind of half happy and half terrified right now. When I wrote my own submission to the Impact CSU Young Writers Contest in the ninth grade, I wasn't scared of writing. In fact, I don't think I had learned yet that it was possible to be scared of writing. But like those of you who are being honored tonight for being county finalists, I'm sure you've also figured out that it gets scary as you go on. But when I wrote my submission, I hadn't figured that out yet. I just put a story down on paper. It was one of those stories that was burning a hole in my brain. I had to get it out. And so it became the beginning of a longer story, which has actually never been written. But that, I think, was how I really started to figure out that I was a writer, that feeling that, for those of you who are shopaholics, you just kind of have to spend the money that's in your pocket. If you're a writer, you have to tell the story that's in your head. At any rate, like I said, this story got written. It found its way into the hands of a wonderful high school English teacher. And before I really knew what was happening, I had submitted it to the Impact contest, and all of a sudden, I had won. That was the moment when I realized that, hey, I might actually be good at writing. But it was also the moment when I learned that writing can be an incredibly intimidating experience. Writing for an audience, and that's any kind of audience, forces you to reveal little pieces of your soul. Often to total strangers, and often to face criticism, misinterpretation, or what I think is worst, for people to look at it once, not appreciate it, and forget it completely. So I avoided that at the age of 14, and I think my intuition was already starting to tell me that it was beginner's luck. I had this feeling that this was rare, this was precarious, it wasn't going to hold on. You know, there were 15 other or 14 other people in the room with me that night who hadn't won, but who were also really smart and had just won $1,000 for it. So I think at that moment when I actually sat at this dinner and realized that I could write well, that I could actually be good at it, it could actually go somewhere, I became absolutely terrified. What if I tried again and I failed and people laughed at me for it? What if it was just that one story, that one kind of time that I had this beautiful vision from somewhere, and then it left me and it went to somebody else. So that fear sounds overblown and it sounds exaggerated, but for those of you who've never tried to write creatively, I have to tell you, it's a really personal enterprise. It's, you know, as if you're giving someone else a pair of glasses through which they can see the world exactly as you see it, but the really terrifying thing is that if they're smart and they turn around, they can see directly into you. At least that's how I feel when I write. You know, I give somebody a story of mine and like, yeah, you know, it's cool, it's a story. But if they read between the lines, they can pretty much tell 99% of who I am, which means that they can misunderstand it or they can make fun of it, and there's nothing that I can do about it. So I think when I was, you know, 14, I wasn't scared, but all of a sudden when I was here and I was about to turn 15, I got, you know, absolutely horrified of what writing could mean if it turned out that I was bad at it. Rejection from college, which I experienced like everyone else here probably has or will from one college or another, that's bad. You know, romantic rejection, that sucks. But writing rejection, I think, is the worst. So, you know, there I was a freshman in high school, and I was already accomplished, which still sounds so strange. But I think I was already timid as a writer. And if I look back at what I did in high school, I can still see, I guess, the point at which I got a little scared. I think I started thinking too much. I started erasing too much. I started even holding off too much. I haven't written a story that long since I was a freshman in high school. And to make matters worse, I don't think I've ever really gotten back all of the courage or the fearlessness or just the plain old freedom and energy that I had when I was 14 and I wrote my submission. And you know, to some extent, those things are probably irredeemable. They, you know, disappear when you grow up, no matter whether you're writing or you're doing something else. And I don't mean to draw a negative portrait of my writing life at all. You know, I got scared. I stayed scared for a while. But I think some of my former impulses stayed with me, and some of them got much stronger. One of those things was to figure out as much as I possibly could about how to write well so that rejection wouldn't ever happen to me. And I was blessed with wonderful teachers and a wonderful family and other people who helped me figure all of those things out, learn how to be a better writer. And I was lucky enough, or I don't think I was smart enough, I think I was just lucky enough to seek out every possible opportunity to make my writing better, to learn what I could do that I had never tried before. I had a teacher who helped me with playwriting. I don't think I was ever very good at it, but just to try it, with poetry, with fiction, with short stories, with essays. And I think at some point I learned that being a good writer doesn't mean producing good writing all the time. In fact, it means producing terrible writing a lot of the time. But that's just a byproduct of the good stuff. And you figure that out, and then it doesn't seem quite so bad, and rejection seems a little more livable. So although I haven't really given advice to this many people ever before, here's my first try. Get scared all you want, because probably when it happens, if it happens to you, you won't be able to stop it. But don't let yourself get scared away. I got scared away, I think, for a little bit, and then I just discovered that writing, in every kind of respect, writing essays, writing fiction, writing poems, writing everything, is what I love to do, and it's wonderful, and it's what I've made kind of a career out of academically, and it's where I want to go for the rest of my life. And I never would have figured that out if I hadn't kind of kept writing no matter what was happening to me, and tried different kinds of writing no matter what I thought the outcome was going to be. So I guess to all of you here in the room who are finalists tonight, whether or not you know it yet, writing well is hands down your greatest asset. It will help you more in life than anything else, I think, that you can say for yourselves. And maybe there's some amazing violinist or I don't know, ballerina in the room, and if that's your gift, then fine, that's your gift, but I think it's writing. It will help you win arguments, it will help you pass classes, it will help you get into college, it will help you lie to your parents, you know, it's, if you're a good writer, you can do anything. It will help you, I think, figure out what you want to do with your lives as you go around making people believe your every word, which is just kind of a bonus. And it will help you probably someday land your dream jobs. So no matter what happens, don't get scared away from it. Don't stop doing it, and push it, I guess, to the furthest possibilities that you can find. Because, you know, no matter how much your friends hate you, when you can turn out a 6-hour essay and somehow, miraculously, you get an A back on it, writing will get you out of things, and it will get you into doors that you never dreamed could be open to you. So keep doing it. And despite my inexperience, I actually have a second piece of advice that I want to share with tonight's honorees. Simply put, always write the truth. I don't mean the truth in the nonfiction sense of the word. I don't mean, you know, cold hard facts. Those are boring. Writers aren't interested in those, at least not the kinds of writers that are being honored here tonight. But what I've learned in the past 8 years is that all the great writers of history, all the ones that have inspired me, that make me keep coming back to them, they understood something about human nature. Whatever it was, it might have been a small insight, it might have been a huge one. But they wrote it down, and they wrote it with brilliant clarity or incisive humor or devastating beauty, and that's why they're famous, that's why they make us laugh, and that's why they make us cry. You know, no matter how out of date your favorite writer is, no matter how many centuries ago he or she wrote, those people are famous because they tell the truth, and not just about the person who was sitting next to them one night at, you know, a boring dinner party 300 years ago, but they tell the truth about people, and those things are timeless. You know, I hate to say this because there's a lot of guys in this room, but I'm going to use Jane Austen as an example, mostly because I know by heart the opening line of Pride and Prejudice, which is, it is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife. Now, I can see some people mouthing that, so I know I'm not the only one. That's no longer a truth universally acknowledged. In fact, I think it's more of a truth universally acknowledged by a lot of today's single young women that single young men are not looking for marriage at all. But Jane Austen is still famous, and people still read this over and over and over again. She's wildly popular. And it's not because she knew the truth about marriage for the rest of eternity. It's because she knew the truth about people, about human nature, human families. I think, you know, let's be honest, human love. She's a romantic writer. And that's what keeps us turning the pages of her novels. And, you know, like her, all the best writers have a gift for weaving those little pieces of timeless truth into prose. And they make it kind of seem so artless and so easy and so simple that we forget that those are the things that we're reading. But I think you all know, you've picked up a book or a poem or a story, whatever it is, and all of a sudden you're reading it and you stop and you point at it and you say, that right there is how I'm feeling. That writer knows. That's exactly what it feels like. That's where great writing comes from. And all of you here tonight have proven that you can do it. That's why you're here. But bring those things out, cultivate that gift, because if you can continue to portray the truth like that, and it's not always pretty, sometimes it's terrible, sometimes it's horrible, sometimes it makes you cry as you're writing it, sometimes you want to throw the papers out the window, but if you can blend the truth of this world into your fictional universes, then you will speak to people in a way that nobody else can. You will open their eyes, you will make them stop in the middle of whatever it is that they're doing, make them reconsider the things that they know about themselves and about the world around them. And I know the other keynote speaker here tonight, Robert Leuci, has said this much more eloquently than I can, but you really will be able to influence people in a way that doesn't involve yelling at them or talking to them. It's not kind of a political speech that you're giving. It's, you know, not a teacher talking to bored, half-asleep students. It's you having a very personal conversation with people that you might not ever meet, might not ever know, have read what you're writing, but you really will touch people. And the fact that you have the power to change a few minds means, in my opinion anyways, that everything you write is relevant, everything you write has consequences, and everything you write is in some sense a giant responsibility. So in my opinion, writing what is true not only gets you places, but it's also kind of an obligation. You know, I sat listening to Bill Clinton talk 2 weeks ago at Yale's graduation, and he's much better at giving advice than I am, and always will be. And he said that Americans today only listen to the people that agree with them. And I think not only is he right, but that is far more damaging to the writers of the world than it is to everyone else. Because as a writer, you have to listen to everything. And you have to write it down, and you have to soak it up, and you have to live and breathe it, because if you don't, you won't see the whole world, and you know as writers that even though you only write about fragments of it, you have to see the whole thing first. You have to know everything that is going on in every character's head, in every kind of dark corner of the universes that you're writing about. So listen to everything, look at everything, read everything, because if you don't, I think you'll be robbing yourselves of part of your own gift. And if you do, I think you can really get places. So, yes, writing is a job. Yes, writing is a responsibility. But it's also an art. It's a gift. It's a way to chronicle our lives, our emotions, our dreams, our motivations. And, you know, whether you write history essays like me for the last 4 years, or fiction, or whatever it is, even, you know, kind of things that border on the world of nonfiction, which is not what we're here to talk about tonight, but newspaper articles, speeches for people, whatever it is that you write, it'll matter to you and it will matter to everyone that reads it and to everyone that reads it while you're alive and after you're dead, so don't try to count your audience because it's probably a lot bigger than you think it is. And, you know, when I say write the truth, don't doubt yourselves, don't censor yourselves. Your most powerful gift is your vision, so write what you see and write everything that you imagine. But telling the world's truths is what will make you a great writer. And, you know, who knows, this program has done pretty well in the past, so you guys have a good chance at this. One day, it might make you a famous one. So congratulations to everyone that's here tonight. I've read parts of what you've written. It's all wonderful. I'm really glad I'm not one of the judges. And I'm really glad I wasn't one of the judges for my year, or for any of the years in between, because it seems to me that there's a lot of talent in this room tonight. So thank you, everyone, and enjoy your dinners.
I think when Lauren was telling her example of the glasses and how you put on glasses and you look out and they look back, it tells you a little bit about her writing and why she won in the year that she won. And for all of you who are in the room who are winners tonight, I do have to tell you that the judges work very hard over choosing who wins in each county and who wins the state award. These are professional writers who are judging your work, and believe me, I've sweated over many of them. There's a lot of thinking that goes into it. There's a lot of rereading and marking papers up. And then, as Chandra knows, you get into a room together and you battle it out. And everybody comes in with their favorite story or their favorite poem and holds it really strongly and really deeply to their hearts. So I don't want any of you to think that it was a quick read and we just said, okay, let's go to lunch. It is something that we take very seriously, and that's probably why our writers have had so much success in the years since. Okay, it's time for dinner. It's time for the Jen Allen Big Band. I want to thank the Vice Chancellor of the State University System for being with us, Dr. Leuci Farrow. She's going to be joining us later to give out the awards. Thank you so much, and let's have some music and some food. Big band, and they're fabulous vocalists. They are phenomenal. Yes.
Where are they going to stand so I can get a shot?
Mm-hmm. We're just figuring out logistics here, where the honorees are going to stand. And I think probably, why don't we move these chairs so we'll have some room for them. But before we actually hand out the certificates, we do have another speaker. And I do want to thank a couple of other people. One of them is Elaine Clark of Impact, who does so much to make this happen every year. I also want to remind you that in the back, just outside the room there, we do have books for sale. Chandra Prasad's books are there, and Bob Lucy's books are there, and you can buy them from Rainey Fay. So if you want them, they're right back there. I think we should give a round of applause to our servers who did such a nice job, and to the Hartford Club for the great meal. And of course to the Jen Allen Band, who were just terrific. Okay, here's how we're gonna go the rest of the night. We're gonna hear from our second speaker, then we're going to hand out the awards to our 16 county prose and poetry winners. After that, we'll have a few words from Louise Farrow of CSU, and then the crowning of the two statewide winners. It won't really be a crown. We don't make you wear a tiara here. We're not like that. But let me tell you about our next speaker, Robert Leuci. He has written more than half a dozen crime novels, including The Snitch, Blaze, Renegades, and Fence Jumpers. Most recently, he published a memoir with HarperCollins, All the Centurions. He was a writer for the TV shows 100 Center Street and Precinct Hollywood. Leuci spent two decades as a New York City police officer, and that era in his life is documented by the book Prince of the City by former New York City Deputy Police Commissioner Robert Daley, and of course in the film of the same name in which Treat Williams played the Leuci character Danny Cielo, and you'll see a resemblance the minute he comes up. In addition to all this, Robert Leuci is an adjunct professor at the University of Rhode Island English Department. Professor Leuci seems to be as flamboyant a character as Detective Leuci was. Here's what some of the students are saying about him on the website ratemyprofessors.com. Leuci is the blank funniest man ever, really cares about you and what you want to learn and write. He is willing to let you write anything. He's hilarious, and he bought us pizza at the end of the year because he swore so much during class. Professor Leuci is a great teacher and great person. He truly cares about his students, and if he gets to know you, he will not hesitate to help you academically and or professionally. He has an unconventional style, but you can learn a lot. I guarantee you will walk away from his class a more knowledgeable person, and that's straight from the horse's mouths. Please welcome novelist and professor Bob Leuci.
I don't know how Andy Thibault, he's a good private investigator, he's a good investigator, period, to find that. My niece told me about this regular professor jazz a while ago, and she teaches at Post College. She said, you know, it's disgusting, the stuff they write about you. And you wonder what that's all about, if that helps you at all. I said, I don't know. What is it? I took a look at it, and I said, boy, what a bunch of stuff. Because it's oftentimes fairly unused fairly by people. Administrators at the university look at these things, regular professor, you know, it's a popularity contest. You know, I spent a little time this afternoon with Lauren. And where's Lauren? You know, Lauren's a serious academic, and she's going to do wonderfully well. And she's a hard worker. It's not that I'm not serious. I am very serious. I love my students. I can relate to many of them, and a lot of them have talent. A lot of them don't. But they try, and that's what's all important. That's what it's all about for all of us, and no matter what it is that we do. Give it a shot and give it our best shot. After a while, you get tired of trying, I suppose, and kind of want to pack it up and go home and relax. But I don't let my students do that. I get a lot of talent development students, students from the inner city and so on. And so many of these kids have hidden talents, and I really mean that. They really do have hidden talents, but they're very shy and self-conscious. And they don't want to express themselves. They don't want to talk in ways or write in ways that's other than the language that they understand or that they use every day. And I spend a lot of time trying to convince them that, you know, just be who it is you are, you know? And I'm going to tell you this. It is not possible. I don't care who you are or what you are or where you've come from. It's not, and you want to be a writer. You know, everyone wants to be a writer. I mean, everybody has a story to tell. We all do, in fact, by the way. Most of us do, anyway. But it's not possible to be a writer, any kind of writer, unless you read. You know, I mean, the idea that anyone could go out and begin to write or spend time writing without reading is ridiculous, you know. And so I try to convince my students to read, how important it is to read. But read the things that you can relate to. Read the things that you're going to enjoy. Read the things that will keep you reading. I don't want you to read something that you're going to go throw the book against the wall. You know, that's not going to help us, either you or me. You know, we'll get to Tolstoy, it's fine, read it. You know, you'd be surprised, give it a try. And it's amazing what these kids can do when they give themselves a chance. The trouble is most kids really that come from the inner cities really don't have time to give themselves a chance. Their big concern is survival. Their big concern is getting from point A to point B without being intimidated, without being shook down, without having problems. And you know, we're still in those places. This country has changed a great deal, but not all that much. I was a policeman for 20 years. I spent most of my time doing work in narcotics and organized crime. You know, and it's so funny. My first job in the police department, my very first job, was a long, long time ago, was as a student in a high school. And they asked me to go in and buy drugs and see if he could do it. And I was in this high school in Brooklyn. It was then called East New York Vocational High School. In those days, like I say, it's a half a century. You know, I looked like I was 15, so they put me in this high school. And the principal of the high school said to me, you know what, I am so pleased you're here, you know, but we don't have a real serious problem, He said, but we have a bit of a problem. Let's see what you can do. Well, within 2 weeks, I bought from 25 different students. And in those days, they were selling heroin, and they were selling marijuana, of course, and pills and all sorts of things, but they were also selling guns. Back then, we're talking about 1964, do you know? And then I went back to the principal, and he called me in his office and said to me, how dare you cross this hallowed line? How dare you come in here and embarrass my students and embarrass me? He said, how dare you do this? You manipulated these. I said, I manipulated these kids. These kids are dope dealers. This is 1964. And what is the answer? I've been around it all my adult life. I've been around drugs all my adult life in one form or another, mostly in enforcement. And I don't know what the answer is. You know, I write about it. I spend time doing research. I've been around a lot of people who aren't around any longer. I've seen a lot of policemen go to prison. I've seen federal agents go to prison. I've seen lawyers go to prison. I've seen judges go to prison. I've seen all things, politicians go to prison, all because of our drug laws. And you wonder, what is the answer? Mexico is anarchy. That gorgeous, beautiful country is so far out of control. It's just absolutely indescribable. Okay, what's going on the border? Well, the border, they say, is pretty safe, but it's the rest of the country that's gone up in smoke. What if we change the laws overnight? What if we decriminalize a lot of these drugs? I'm not saying all drugs. People say, well, let's decriminalize. No, you can't decriminalize drugs. I mean, you can't decriminalize all drugs. We certainly don't want to decriminalize hard drugs, do we? And if we're going to decriminalize it, who are we going to decriminalize it for? Everyone above the age of 21? Well, most people that use those drugs are under the age of 21. So there'll always be a black market. But to put people in prison or spend our time, you know, investigating people that smoke marijuana is, you know, sort of a joke, isn't it? It's past that time. So it is an uplifting little talk I'm giving you, isn't it? I don't know, I get into this shit, I mean, honestly, I really do. You know, I spend a lot of time lecturing cops, too. You know, I used to teach at the FBI Academy in Quantico, Virginia. You want to see a bunch of straight-laced heroes of the American way. But let me tell you, they're impressive. And they are, in fact, impressive. You know? So, you know, sometimes we, you know, tongue-in-cheek, we talk about FBI agents. They're pretty good. Our DEA agents are pretty good. Our policemen are pretty good. Do we have dishonest ones? Yeah, we got plenty. Do we have dishonest politicians? Plenty. You know, we are who we are. We're Americans. We don't take our police, our agents, our lawyers, our politicians from Saturn. We don't recruit from the moon. They're reflections of us, all of us. That's who they are. That's who our cops are. That's who our politicians are. That's who everyone is. If you're a racist, you can't expect not to have a racist cop. If your political system is corrupt, you can't expect not to have corrupt cops. That's just the way it is. And that's what there is to write about. Getting back to writing, which is a much more pleasant subject. Yeah, I've written 7 books, you know, and I've screenplays and things like that, and I love writing. It is what I've always wanted to do, blah, blah, blah. That is the most cliched line there really is. You know, I have kids coming to me. I see some of these kids that were in the workshop today. Adorable, you know, talented. And you hope they stay with it. You hope that they really spend time thinking about what it is to be a writer, how much they enjoy doing it, and stay with it. Of course, figure out a way to make a living, you know, and then worry about your writing. It's a difficult profession to earn a living in, but, you know, people do it. People do it all the time, and sometimes people are hugely successful. One of the things to realize that publishers nowadays much prefer publishing people who are just starting out. Because the publishing business today is essentially a marketing business. You know, I mean, I have editors that are 26, 27 years old, you know, and some of the finest writers in the country, they never heard of. I'm telling you, I'm serious. They never heard of. And if I ask them to read something, you know, the editors, by the way, they don't read. And they'll tell you, essentially, I know how to sell books. You know, I don't know how to edit them. You edit them. I said, okay. That's what I have a computer for. You know what I'm saying? I mean, the business has changed, things have changed, but, you know, the venues are open. There's so many places nowadays, you know, where things can be seen. That is a wonderful world that we all live in, this creative world. It's a wonderful place to be. You know, we get to see the world from a very special place through our own prism, you know, our own way of looking at things, whether you're an artist, whether you're a musician, whether you're a writer, whether you're a poet, poets. Can you imagine spending your life being a poet? You want to cut your wrist now. You know? My best friend in life is a poet by the name of Kit Hathaway. Kit Hathaway is a very famous poet amongst poets. He lives up in Maine. And I've been after him for years, and he writes so beautifully, trust me. I mean, he's a very close friend of the poet laureate of the country. All poets love him. I mean, he's a really impressive guy. He turned down, he had tenure at three different universities, walked away from it three different times. So now he's up in Maine, living up in Maine, and he's, you know, worrying about how he's going to pay his bills. And I said, Kid, write a novel. I'll come up with the plot. You write it. You're a gorgeous writer. You're a gorgeous. After him and after him and after him and after him. Finally, one day he said, Bob, I am a poet. Excuse my language. I apologize. I said, yeah, what does that mean? He says, yeah, I don't write novels. I'm a poet. And I need to suffer. I said, well, you're suffering, all right. Paying three ex-wives and everything else. And your kids aren't talking to you. You're doing great. Working in a drugstore. But the truth of the matter is, he writes wonderful poetry. So I give my hats off to all you poets. You know, I really, you know, I think it's a magnificent thing. And listen, when we think about this pyramid of the art of writing, the true art of writing, right on top, the tippy top of poets, that's it. They're it. And after that come a number of other people, you know, romance novelists or some down somewhere in there. Around the center, below the center of the pyramid. Television writers are right there in the middle of the pyramid. You know, and that's really the way it works. I mean, I'm quoting from Stephen King. I'm picking on him. You know, he's great. You know, he sells more books in like 10 minutes than I've sold my whole life. And he's a very good writer, actually. So look, all of you who love writers, all of you who are writers, all of you who hope to become more better writers than you are now, I've had a wonderful time here. I always have a wonderful time here. And when I think about Andy Tebow, and I think to myself, this SOB, I mean, he never stopped writing. I never gotten more emails. I have 150 students who I got to worry about for the next semester, next year, actually. I get less emails from them. And they're always complaining, trust me. You know, every day. And it's in this, and look at this website, and it's more writing. Write a book, Andy. Tie yourself out a little bit. It's a marathon. You got a lot to say? Say it, covers of a book. Second time I've been here, last time I came here, they put me up in a ring, a boxing ring. They put me in a boxing ring. I'm getting to the age now, too. You know, I can't drink before I give a talk or have a, you know, talk. And I had a couple of drinks. I couldn't get up the stairs at a boxing ring. 1.5 drinks. I'm a real big slugger. You know, but there were fantastic poets and writers and people all coming together, everybody laughing, having a good time. I'm thinking about how the hell am I going to get home? Where am I? It's getting dark. I'm scared. I was a cop for 20 years. I got shot, stabbed, run over. Got to meet Trey Williams, who played me in the movies. You know, Trey comes from Connecticut. He's a great guy. You know, all this kind of stuff. Lived a life, but now I'm afraid to go out to the car by myself. Not because anyone's going to attack me. I'm not going to be able to find my keys. I'm going to have, did I pee enough before I left? This is the worst part of it. Everybody says the greatest part, getting older. You know, this is a golden year. Oh, yeah, really? I prefer having bricks thrown at me, you know, when I was 21 and I could run fast. I wish you all really, it's great to see you all here, and I'm going to get out of your way so you can give these wonderful young people their awards, and then we all can go home. Good night. Thank you.
Only Andy Tebow would have been able to persuade Bob Leuci to come to this event and to be so inspiring. And Kate, please stand up and so everyone can see you have not slit your wrists yet and you're really okay. Kate Russian right here, or poet. Okay. Well, it's time for us to hand out the awards, and here to do that and to say a few words is Louise Farrow, who is the Senior Vice Chancellor for Academic and Student Affairs of the Connecticut State University System, the former president of Mercy College, and a great friend of the Connecticut Young Writers. We're so happy to have her here.
Since I have all these goodies in my hands, I will confine myself to a very few words indeed. There were really much more brilliant people than I at the podium tonight, and you have been talked at a lot. So let me just say that we are delighted at the State University System to continue to be sponsors of this wonderful program that enables people to have a stage, that enables you all to have an audience, and that enables a whole generation of young people to find their voice and express themselves. It's a very, very important work that the Young Writers Trust does, and we're very happy to be a part of it. So without further ado, shall we start reading names?
Let's do it.
All right. what we're going to do first is announce the county winners in each category first. And then the very last thing is the two statewide winners. So the new London County Poetry Champion, Grace Beggins. Are you here, Grace? All right. And you're going to have to give us just a moment because we have to do photo ops. This is very important.
Congratulations. Smile. There you go.
Are we good again? All right.
Okay.
All
right.
You need to get in the picture here, ma'am. Stand on the other side. Okay. Windham County Poetry Champion, Josh Breyer. There will be no slitting of the wrist tonight. Come stand in the middle. Let me hand you your certificate. Whoops, wrong hand. We'll get this right. Turn around. There we go.
Okay.
We don't want you to break. Fairfield County Poetry Champion, Julia Albano. And the poets are first, is it?
That's why we do it this way.
Come over here, right on the other side of me, please. Thank you very much, and I'll hand this to your left hand and shake your right hand. There you go.
One more.
Oh. We're doing this twice. Okay. Litchfield County Poetry Champion, Carter Brown. Middlesex County Poetry Champion, Olivia Del, you're going to have to pronounce that for me, Olivia. Del Judas. I knew it was easy. Just, there are too many letters there. Thank you. Congratulations.
Push up. One more. Thank you.
Okay.
Wonderful. Thank you.
New Haven County Poetry Champion, Mary Margaret Meehan. A little bit of an obstacle course to get up here. Congratulations.
Right in the.
Come right in between us, yeah, and we'll pose.
Thank you.
Okay. Congratulations. Hartford County poetry champion Morgan Finn.
That sounds like a poet's name.
It does.
Morgan Finn.
Thank you.
Well, you are a poet, so congratulations.
I'm sorry.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Tolland County poetry champion Timothy West.
You'll probably be wondering why everybody else is dressed up, and Austin, right?
Yeah.
You go by Austin?
Yeah.
Is in his baseball uniform. That's because he just pitched in the Class L championship baseball game.
Excellent.
In Fairfield, and came here right afterwards. So
excellent.
For people who say that athletes are like poetry in motion, Austin is one of them. And they played a great game. Unfortunately, it was what, 4-3? 5-4. Okay, well, we're very, very glad you're with us, and you're a champion to us, for sure.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
New London County prose champion, Gloria Creamer.
Thank you.
Windham County prose champion Anna Nassif. Did I say that correctly? Close.
Thank you.
Fairfield County prose champion Zina Advani. Litchfield County prose champion Claire Birch.
Congratulations.
Middlesex County prose champion Chelsea Melanson. New Haven County prose champion Noah Perito.
Are you also a musician?
Hartford County prose champion Sheldon Gasco.
Congratulations.
Tolland Sutherland County Pros Champion Kyle Nealand.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Gosh,
that's fine. Excellent. Okay. Ta-da! We need a drum roll, but the drums are all packed up, so. Thank you, thank you. We'll start with poetry. Connecticut State Poetry Champion, Grace Beggins. Punish them and ask them to say a few words, but I thought that was mean. So. Connecticut State Prose Champion, Sheldon Gaskell. I see you have some fans among the judges. Congratulations to everyone.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Farrell. If you'd like to read some of the winning entries, in fact, if you'd like to read all of them, we do have copies. Where are we going to have them as people are leaving? Do you want to bring them, put them back where the book stand is?
Yeah.
Okay, so if you want to grab them, go ahead and grab those. We have some copies for you. I thank everybody for being here, particularly, as many of you know who've been involved with us over the years, it has been a dramatic and even a rough couple of years for the Connecticut Young Writers Awards. We've had major disruption to our funding, two changes of venue in the last 2 years, and a great deal of uncertainty about how or even with, if we'll continue down this road. It's a time in the country right now, and a lot of people and organizations are looking around for an angel or two to help them through. We hope we find ours, and maybe he or she is sitting in this room right now. Meanwhile, I do want to thank, in closing, the actual angel who has continued to keep our ship sailing through the tempest. The fact that Andy Thibault is notoriously shy of publicity and, in fact, is hiding in the back corner there. Andy, come up here. He is very shy of publicity, makes us want to thank him even more loudly.
Thanks.
Thank you, Andy. Great job all these years. It's been wonderful. Would you like to talk?
Thanks. Thank you. All I wanted to say was it's time for Bob and me to go to the bathroom, but he beat me to it. So I'm kind of upset with him. You know? And Paul is going to invite you to go with us, my friend Paul. Well, a lot of people want to keep this going, and obviously there's a lot of talent and energy that got us this far, so... Chancellor Carter will be hosting a meeting in the fall. Between now and then, we have various splinter groups and sleeper cells that aren't really doing anything, but if anybody wants to wake them up, we can probably do something, but I have no clue what, so thank you.
He always says that, and somehow he got us to this point. So for those of you that don't know Andy, besides being out there always encouraging young writers, he's frequently busy in his many other capacities. I first met him when he was a boxing judge. He's been a private detective, an investigative journalist. When you combine all of his interests and his personal connections, what you end up with are truly impossible to describe events. I know, I've tried to describe them, like say a night of poetry and boxing at the Hartford Club. Well, that was a one-of-a-kind event, and that's because that's what Andy himself is. So Andy Tebow, thank you so much for making this happen for all these writers all these years. And now I just want to bring this to a conclusion. Thank you all for being here tonight to support these young writers. I wish you all good luck, and I'll tell you the one thing that I think every year when I read your submissions, gee, I wish I'd written that. So have a good night.
If you enjoyed the preceding broadcast, you're sure to like other CTN programming. Stay with the Connecticut Network for the most comprehensive coverage of the state's legislative, executive, and judicial branches of government, the state's electoral process, and other events of public interest across Connecticut. View the program guide on our website or subscribe to our daily schedule, and stay tuned for more of your state and your government on the Connecticut Network.
Each year, the decisions that impact you and your community the most are made by your state government. Count on the Connecticut Network to keep you connected 24 hours a day.